Have a good time. All right. Last week, Byron, our friend and elder, who's off on a weekend with his lovely wife up in a mountain somewhere, introduced the series with a parable. It's a parable you might have come across before. It's Wes Seeliger's Western Theology about settlers and pioneers. Let me just give you a brief recap in case you weren't here. In settler theology, the primary goal is security, feeling safe, feeling okay, security in heaven after you die, and security right now in the middle of all of life's uncertainty. And so in this parable, it made some comparisons. It said that settlers sort of see God as the mayor who keeps everything running smoothly, keeps everything functioning the way it's supposed to. Jesus is the sheriff who stops the bad guys and decides who gets to go to jail. The Holy Spirit is the saloon girl. That one might have been interesting for you. But if you think about it, it's really quite a great picture because the saloon girl's job is to make sure everybody feels okay, to make sure people are happy and comfortable, right? And then the church is the courthouse, this symbol of security and authority and stability. It's where taxes are paid. It's where the rules are made. Life in town for the settlers is all about doing what's necessary for everybody to feel safe and secure and stable. And then there was this contrast that Byron shared, this pioneer theology, which had all the same figures but some different characters to explain them. The primary goal in pioneer theology is to move forward on the trail, moving toward new life, where God is leading us. And so in this picture, God is the trail boss, who's setting the direction, saying, this is where we're going together. And Jesus is the scout who walks alongside the pioneers, who goes everywhere that they go, who's been through it before, who never leaves them alone. The Holy Spirit is the unpredictable, crazy buffalo hunter. And no one quite knows what to expect from him, but he provides the food that keeps the pioneers able to move forward. The church is the covered wagon, this moving home, right? It's not that comfortable. It's kind of bandaged together, but it keeps moving forward along the trail. And life along the trail for the pioneers is about the adventure of growth. It's about moving forward on this path. It's about trust and faith. It's not always comfortable. That's just a part of being on the trail, but it's the way to new life. All right, now before we jump into the new material today, I want to just stop and take a few minutes and hear from you what came up for you last week as we were thinking about this. Maybe it was during service or perhaps it was in your home group as you were discussing it. Did you see yourself in some way in this parable of the settlers and pioneers? Did you give you some kind of understanding or connecting point for how you've done church in your life? What would you like to share? Just speak up. Well, thank you. We wished you had too.
I wasn't here, but what you were just saying, I just had to laugh because as much as I've always thought the settler life, I've always been a reluctant pioneer. You know, it's like I've never been settled anywhere in my life, so I'm always trying to look ahead.
Okay. Anybody else? Yeah, Brian. The crazy buffalo hunter, yeah. Unpredictable, carries a gun, never quite sure what he's going to do. Yeah, I could see that. I could see that. Did anybody connect with the tension between these two, kind of seeing yourself sort of bouncing back and forth? What? You're, yeah, Kim.
I was just going to say that I was thinking, what about those people that they're settled, they have a little home, like a little house on the prairie, but they're, you know, they're way far away from the village, mm-hmm. You know, and I was thinking, I'm reading into that or whatever, and then I realized that probably that actually fits my life, like an in-between, kind of like not able to quite pick one or the other.
Bonnie. Well, that's a great question. I think last week we talked about the fact that we kind of feel the tension between security and adventure. In the parable, it's clearly set up that pioneering is the call, right? God calls us to move out into new life. And that pushes some buttons for me because I like things to be in order and predictable at some level. But Yeah, it's just a parable. So I wouldn't say, you know, people who live in houses with fences are not growing spiritually. But the idea is to think about this tension in spiritual growth, because one of the things that happens in religion, right, is that religion tends to be about wanting to feel safe and secure, right? We kind of make our religion about being comfortable and knowing what to do and knowing who's in and who's out and all those kinds of things. That's what tends to happen with religion. And the story we get in the New Testament, well, really the story we get in the whole Bible, if you pull back and look at the big picture, is that God's constantly calling people out of that place where they were and into something new. You know, Abraham's called out of civilization in Ur to go who knows where. You know, Israel's called out of slavery in Egypt to go to the promised land. You know, and that repeats over and over and over again. And so there is a little bit of discomfort in this idea that God maybe wants us to move forward in growth. And maybe growth doesn't happen where you're most comfortable. All right, let's pray, and we'll try some new stuff on for size today. Father, as we have the opportunity to think about our life together and who you're calling us to be, I pray that you will enliven our hearts and enlighten our minds, that we could understand you more and have a compelling picture about how we can move forward in life with you. Guide our time. Speak to our hearts. In Jesus' name, amen. There's a particular story that my kids love to hear. They love to hear it enough that they will ask for it if they haven't heard it recently enough. And it is the story of us. It's the story of our family. Every kid wants to know how they came to be, right? The truth is we all have this question, right? Where did I come from? And this story that locates our identity, this story doesn't just start with them being born in the hospital, right? This story actually goes back to the people that made them. You know, in the case of kids, it goes back to parents and maybe even beyond that. See, their identity is their own. But their identity happens in the context of the people who made them. So when we started telling this story to Emerson, it began with Christina and I meeting and talking about our relationship and the course of our relationship, and then being married for 7 years, and then deciding that we were going to have a baby, and this baby was this incredible, powerful, inquisitive little girl, and that was her. And then Lucas joined our family, and it was apparent that the story had to expand. Not just change to include him. It had to expand. Why? Because Lucas is adopted. And so his identity is his, but it happens within the context of the people who made him and the people who made him family. And so as we wove Lucas into this story of who we are, the story, it began to change. In fact, it goes back now, when we tell it, it goes back to my dad and my mom. Why? Because my dad and mom adopted me. And that gives us context to talk to Lucas about where he came from. And so we tell the kids that there's really only one way. I mean, there's asterisks on all of these things, right? But there's really only one way that kids get born so far, till the test tubes are all worked out. There's pretty much one way that kids get born. But there are lots of ways that kids come into families. And in our family, we've experienced two of the ways that kids come into families. And so some children are born in the belly of their birth mother, and that birth mother becomes their mother for life. And that's how Christina came into her family, and that's how Emerson came into our family. But then some kids are born from the belly of their birth mother, and for a variety of reasons, someone else becomes their mother or their father. Well, that's how I came into my family, and that's how Lucas came into our family. And they love to hear these stories. And I believe it's because we all have this need, deeply rooted, to know where we have come from. And this question of identity, it's found over and over and over in the Bible. In fact, you could really say that the Bible is an identity story. It's who we are, who we've come from, the people that have made us. God tells us this over and over again. One very succinct telling of it is in Galatians 4. If you have your Bibles or Bible reading devices, go ahead and open up to this passage. We'll come back to it a couple of times. Galatians 4, chapter 4, like I said, verses 4 to 7. Listen to these verses. This is an identity story. When the time came to completion, God sent his son, born of a woman, born under the law, to redeem those that were under the law, so that we might receive adoption as sons. And because you are sons, God has sent the Spirit of his Son into our hearts, crying, Abba, Father. So you are no longer a slave, but a son, and if a son, then an heir through God. Just hold on to that verse. So this is a story about identity, who we are, where we've come from. And like any good identity story, it gives us a perspective on ourselves and on God. And it gives us a way to live in the world that we're in. Now, this particular story of identity is the story of our adoption. It connects deeply with me personally. At just the right time, God sent his son Jesus. Jesus came to us as a rescuer. This rescue gave us the status of adopted children. And now that we're adopted children, we can relate to God in a different way. We can relate to God as Daddy, calling out to God, Abba, Father. This is not, O Lord, magnificent, high and lifted up. This is not the stern Father of justice. This is Daddy, a little child's cry, an intimate relationship. But if Jesus was coming on a rescue mission, this is kind of what the passage says, at just the right time Jesus came. If Jesus was coming on a rescue mission, what is it that we needed to be rescued from? Look at the verse, verse 7. What does this verse say we were being rescued from? What do you see there? So you are no longer a slave, but a son. You are no longer a slave, but now a precious child and an heir. That means before Jesus, our identity was slavery. After Jesus, our identity is precious childhood, precious children of God, an heir, a member of the family. And there's this tension now, slavery, sonship, slavery, servant, precious child, and heir. And you know what? This is the exact same tension that we've seen in so many places. When we were studying the book of Ephesians, we saw this tension, right? The old walk, the new walk. This old way of living, this old pattern of living, and this new pattern of living. Remember, taking off the old, renew the mind, put on the new? Same tension. Paul also uses the image of the old flesh, the old person, and the new spirit. We see the same story over and over through Scripture. We talked about the same tension last week in the parable of the settlers and the pioneers. There's this tension, right? Are we going to settle for security and comfort and what we know? Are we going to head out in adventure? Are we going to head out in growth? And our struggle, here we are, followers of Jesus, trying to live our life in the middle of Portland, 2014. Our struggle is choosing to live as a loved child and heir when we are constantly tempted to go back and live like slaves. Tempted isn't even quite the right word, because temptation makes it sound like, you know, oh, come back and live as a slave. It's not that. It's just habits. It's just that we're so comfortable with the thing that we knew. We have lifelong habits of living a certain way, and when you get stretched, what do? You go back to your habits. When you get in stress, what do? You go back to your habits, right? And so we have this tension of living this new way, son and heir, or going back to this habit of living as a slave. Living as a slave. That's another story in the Bible, right? This core formative story of God's people in the Old Testament is the story of the Exodus. So God's people move to Egypt. Over time, they become slaves. And they're in slavery in Egypt for 400 years. That's a really long time. Quick math, 400 years from now, back ago, is how long ago? What year? 1614. Okay, 1614, Pocahontas was alive. I don't just know that, I looked it up. Pocahontas was alive. So was Galileo. Galileo was alive. The King James Version of the Bible in its original Shakespearean English was just being written 400 years ago. Here's a question. Do you have any idea what your ancestors were up to 400 years ago? Like, maybe some of you have done really good genealogy and you have an idea that you had an ancestor in England or you had an ancestor in Japan. Maybe you know that. But do you know anything about the culture of their family? who they were, what mattered to them, what their values were. Do you have any idea? No, of course you don't, because 400 years is a really long time. Think about what you know about the culture of your ancestors 400 years ago. And that's about what Israel knew about their ancestors 400 years ago. See, 400 years is time enough to lose track of your identity. It's time enough to lose track of the promises of God. It's time enough to lose track of the values that shaped you. And you begin to take on new values. Who were they for 400 years? Slaves. 400 years, right? That's a long enough time that it's not just you. It's you and your parents and your parents' parents and your parents' parents' parents and your parents' 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 parents. So you're kind of in this spot where this is what we know. Right? And if you've been in a certain identity for 400 years, what do you expect is going to be the case for your kids? Probably the same thing. This is who we are. This is what we do. We've been slaves for as long as we can remember. We're probably going to stay that way. That's the mindset, the identity mindset that happened for God's people in 400 years of slavery in Egypt. It was their life. Born in slavery, die in slavery, figure out how to make it work while you're in slavery. And that's what they did, right? We all do this. We figure out how to make life work, and we build habits to get by in the life we have, even if it's not a good life. We build habits. We have coping mechanisms. We have tools that we use, even if they're broken, even if they're sinful, even if they're destructive. They're the ones we have because they're the ones that work because we're trying to get by in the middle of the circumstance we're in. That's where they were at. That was their identity. And that slave identity comes with a worldview. Because as a slave, you don't have autonomy. You're doing what you're told. You don't have value because you're a tool. You're an interchangeable tool. And what do you do when an interchangeable tool is not working well? What do you do with it? You throw it away. There's more, right? So there's no particular value on you as an individual because you're just one of many replaceable, interchangeable tools. And so this worldview that comes with slavery as an identity is a worldview of fear. It's a worldview of scarcity. It's a worldview of no hope. And so when God sent Moses, you know, burning bush, rod turning to a snake, the whole crazy deal, when God sends Moses to Egypt to bring the people out, you have to understand this. The project that God was embarking on was way bigger than getting the slaves out of Egypt. Freeing the slaves was not just about moving them geographically out of Egypt. See, we have this incredible story. You know, it makes a great movie, lots of special effects. Moses shows up, there's God, there's Pharaoh, 10 plagues, and all of a sudden the people are freed. Only they weren't freed. Their bodies were freed. They were in a different place. They didn't have taskmasters with whips over them, but they had taskmasters in their hearts because they'd been slaves for 400 years, and that was their identity, that was their habit, that was how they'd learned to make do. And so now they were out of Egypt. Their bodies were free. But they were still living out of this identity of slavery because they were slaves who had come from slaves. And they related to God as slaves, and the worldview of slaves is fear and no hope and scarcity. And so they related to God that way. They related to God out of fear and scarcity and no hope. You see, God had gotten the people out of slavery. But at Mount Sinai, with the giving of the Ten Commandments, God began a bigger project, getting slavery out of the people. Now, you might think, oh, Ten Commandments, the law, especially if you grew up in church world or if you grew up in more conservative, strict churches, you might think that the law was restraining. But in fact, if you come to Mount Sinai as the son of the son of the son of a slave, whose culture is slavery, whose mindset is slavery, whose worldview is fear and scarcity and lack of hope, if you come to Mount Sinai, the Ten Commandments are a map to freedom. They are the beginning of God changing the identity of these slaves. And God says things to them like this: hey, don't worship gods that enslave you. Only worship the God who liberates you, because who you worship shapes the way you see yourself and the way you live in the world. And God says, hey, don't make gods into idols. Why? Because once it's an idol, you can hold it and have control over it. And the second you have control over God, you're going to start using God to have power over other people. So don't make God into an idol, something that you can control. And don't use God's name to power up over other people. That's another form of idolatry, right? You take God's name and you stamp it on your paperwork so that you have permission to say, God wants me to do this. Don't do that. Don't use God to justify your agenda, because that's a way of having power over people. That's slave mindset. Oh, and take a day of rest every week. Why would that be important to slaves? Right? Because if you're a tool, tools don't get a day off. Tools just need to do the job they were made to do until they break and they're replaced with a new tool, right? And so God says, no, don't think that way. Every single week of your life, you need to take a day for rest. Why? Because you were created as a being who needs rest. You were not created to be a machine. You were not created to be a tool. You were created to live in this ongoing rhythm. Oh, honor your parents. Now, that's an interesting one, right? Again, growing up in church world, that to me, I was always taught that that was about obedience, and it is, but here's an interesting thing. When you honor your parents, you're paying attention to where you came from. You're paying attention to who you are, right? Every person has an identity and a heritage and people that care for them and people that they care for. Let's start by paying attention to that. Let's honor those relationships. Tools don't have those things, right? But people do. Oh, and don't live out of fear and scarcity in such a way that it leads you to kill or to commit adultery or to steal or to lie. Those are all behaviors that come out of your worldview of slavery. Those are not behaviors that come from a worldview of a community that's living free under God. And so the Ten Commandments are God is starting the conversation saying, here's how you guys can live free. And they needed those elementary tools because 400 years of slavery sets up a very strong identity of who they are. But change is hard, right? And Israel needed 40 years in the wilderness to even begin changing the way that they thought about themselves. And what happened when things get hard? What happened? In recovery, you've heard the phrase, or the key flag word, halt. This is an indicator of what you need to be aware of, where you're maybe going to go back into old habits, halt, hungry, angry, lonely, tired, right? When these things are filling your mind, there's a good chance you're going to fall back on your old habits. So pay attention for when you're hungry, angry, lonely, tired. So what happened when Israel was in the desert and they got hungry, angry, lonely, and tired? What did they do? They wanted to go back. It's ridiculous. They wanted to go back to slavery, but why? What was their perspective about it? It was what? It was comfortable. Isn't that crazy? Like getting beaten to do jobs is your comfort zone and you want to go back to it? Right. So there's going to be a place to live if we don't mess it up. There's going to be food to eat if we obey, right? Safety, comfort, right? And so they wanted to go back to that. They wanted to go back to a place with no hope, no future, no freedom, because they knew where their next meal was coming from. Now, maybe you're wondering, okay, Mark, why, this is interesting history, why does this matter to me? What does this have to do with us right now? Well, here's the thing. That journey, that Exodus journey out of slavery across the wilderness, that's the journey that we are all on. Every one of us deals with an enslaved heart. Every one of us does. We face it in different ways. We deal with fear, an addiction, people-pleasing, worry, lust, shame, inferiority, control. We compare and compete in order to feel okay. We try to prove that we're worth something. We try to handle all of this by staying in control. We try to create security for ourselves by building up a structure of something, a structure of career, a structure of finances, a structure of relationships or knowledge. We do all of this to make ourselves feel better. And then Jesus says in John 8:34, Jesus says, I assure you, everyone who commits sin is a slave of sin. All right, honesty in church, anyone commit sin this week? Yeah, all right. Okay, so Jesus says, everyone who commits sin is a slave to sin. Well, slave, that means we can't do what's best for us on our own. That means we don't have the autonomy to make the kind of decisions that we should. We lose our ability to choose. We find ourselves in positions that we can't alter under our own strength. And change is hard. You know it is. You've tried to be a more patient spouse or a more understanding, less demanding parent, or you've tried to stop comfort eating, or you've gone through recovery for addiction, and you've learned in the course of your own life that change is really hard. When something is a deep, embedded habit, when that embedded habit has come close to being part of your identity, it is really hard to change. But that's not what we were made for. Jesus said, I assure you, everyone who commits sin is a slave to sin. But then, in the next sentence, a slave does not remain in the household forever, but a son does. Therefore, if the Son sets you free, you really will be free. That's the rescue. That's why the pioneer path that we started talking about last week is the way for us to engage our relationship with God. Right? In Ephesians, we learn that God's project for us is to grow us up in the image of Christ. You remember that in Ephesians 4? God is maturing us in the image of Christ. So if you haven't figured this out yet in growth, you have not been paying attention. Growing means change. Change means loss. Loss is always painful. That means growing is painful. This is the truth of our lives. If you're going to grow, if you want to become better at anything, if you want to grow personally, emotionally, spiritually, or in your career, you've got to try new things. New things are things you're already not good at. New things are things that you're already not comfortable with. So just stepping into that space is going to be painful for most of us, right? And you try it, and what happens when you do stuff you're not good at most of the time for most of us? What happens? You don't do it very well. You fail. You don't get it right. And what happens when you do stuff and you don't get it right? You feel stupid. People say mean things about you, or you imagine that they do, right? You get this whole insecurity thing going on, and your sense of value starts to collapse, and you start to feel horrible, and then you do worse at the things that you... Like, does anyone experience this? Okay, so this is what happens to us. And if God's agenda for us is growth, that means automatically God's agenda is going to take us through the wilderness. Because that's how we grow. We grow by going into places that are new and different and uncomfortable, and sometimes painful. That's why the pioneer path matters. We've been set free, but it's a freedom to follow on an adventure. Right? We've been set free to participate in an expedition that can change our lives and the world. Lord of the Rings is a favorite movie series of mine, favorite books, favorite story of mine. And if you think about the very beginning of the story, when you're in the Shire, in New Zealand, and everything's beautiful, and little bubbly houses with grass growing on top and flowers and wizards showing up at just the right time, right? When you're there, it feels really wonderful. It feels really nice. Okay, what would have happened if they just stayed? Well, the movie would have been different. The movie would have been how Sauron came to destroy the entire world, right? If they had stayed in the place that felt safe and comfortable, Sauron would have won. And so the call to change the world required somebody to leave the Shire, to step out of the comfortable space, to go on the adventure. Well, that's the journey that we're called to. Our life change requires us to go. Staying is a trap. If we stay, it feels safe. But in fact, the bad stuff that's going on, the slavery habits that we have, all of that junk that's out there, it will overtake us if we stay. The only way forward is to go. Right? God calls Abraham, follow me. God calls Egypt, or God calls Israel out of Egypt, follow me. Jesus calls the disciples, follow me. Right? The early church calls their friends, follow us. Paul tells us in the New Testament, follow me as I follow Christ. This is the story all the way through. Come on, get up, let's go. Come on, get up, let's go. Come on, this is a great place. We've learned a lot here, but let's get up and let's go. because the adventure is out there, the change is out there. Galatians 5:1 gives us an interesting challenge. Christ has liberated us to be free. Sort of seems obvious statement, right? Christ has liberated us to be free. Stand firm then, and don't submit again to a yoke of slavery. Why on earth would there need to be an instruction in the Bible that says, don't go back to slavery? Why is that necessary? Because we do it all the time. Right? We choose to go back to those habits. We choose to go back to those places. When things get hard, we want to go back. And in religion, we create a mess. Because when things get hard and we want our religion to be about security, then we start looking for rules that are clear and to-do lists that let us know where we stand and clarity on who is in and who is out and what kinds of sinners we will welcome here and what kinds of sinners we will not welcome here. And we want to go back to the comforts of old habits that make us feel better in the face of our own fear and insecurity and stress. And that life is tempting. Because a whole lot of uncertainty is just solved for you. That's why we need this reminder. And so we go back to the passage that we started with, Galatians 4:4-7. When the time had come to completion, God sent his Son, born of a woman, born under the law, to redeem those under the law so that we might receive the adoption as sons. And because you are sons, because you are children, God has sent the Spirit of his Son into our hearts, crying, Abba, Father. So you are no longer a slave, but a precious child. And if a precious child, then an heir through God. Jesus came. Jesus rescued. We are now adopted. We can relate to God as Abba Father. We're no longer slaves. That's what God says is true of us now. One of the tasks as followers of Jesus that we've been talking about, the elders have been sharing, we have these two tasks we're focusing on. One is that we are discovering our identity in Christ. The other is that we are learning how to join Christ in his work in the world. Two tasks that are a part of our life as followers of Jesus. This is the first, discovering our identity in Christ. Because we have this identity, this slave identity, that we keep going back to. And so our purpose here as community is to learn who God sees us and then to help each other remember that. Right? To learn who God says we are and then to be the voice of God to each other saying, hey, you are not a slave. Stop with the slave behavior. Hey, we are not slaves. We don't have to relate out of scarcity and fear and lack of hope. Hey, we are free. How are we going to use our freedom today? We get to remind each other of that. That's what our community becomes about. So that when we're struggling, when we have a halt moment, hungry, angry, lonely, tired, when we're dealing with difficult things, somebody in our family will look us in the eye and say, hey, don't be a slave. You don't have to. You're not anymore. And we can do the same for them. You've been set free, and that means you get to choose how to live with your freedom. Together as followers of Jesus, we're on this expedition to this new life, right? No longer slaves. We've been freed to be a blessing in the world. That's our purpose as a church. We summarize it by saying, love God, love people, bless and serve the world. Well, we need to have some conversations about what that's going to really look like among us. That's where we're headed in the coming weeks. Let's pray. Father, it's an easy habit to go back to the slave mentality. It's comfortable, we know it, and yet you're calling us to something new. I know in this room we all experience that slave mentality in different ways. I know that there's people that are dealing with painful relational habits, people that are dealing with addiction, people that are dealing with a desire to find their value in pleasing the people around them. People that are dealing with all sorts of things that captivate their mind and heart. And yet you have broken all that, all those chains, given us the possibility for freedom. And I pray that here at this community, as Bridge City is sort of redefining itself for this season, that you will help us know how we can be a part of helping each other live free, and that we can help the people around us live free. Guide us, in Jesus' name, amen.